I hope everyone's doing well tonight. We've got so far 41 in the room here. So thank you very much for attending, those of you who are with us. And I don't know if there's other rooms piping this in or not. I have no clue, but maybe there are. Welcome to all. It's been a wild and woolly day here, so let me collect my thoughts and we'll get on with it. Let's start off with prayer. If you want to participate in the prayer, please do. And if you don't, just turn your volume down for a couple minutes and you can pick back up with us. But let's pray. Father, we give you praise for another day, for the blessings of this life, for your goodness, your mercy, and your love. We thank you for our Lord Jesus and the free gift of salvation we have through his shed blood. We thank you, Lord, that by your grace and mercy, we're still here in the midst of a crazy world. Thank you, Lord, that you're in control of all the events of the world, that you have a master plan that ultimately will see you win the victory, Lord, in all the craziness and all the evil that's going on in our world around us. Lord, we know that you're coming back again soon. We don't know when that will be, but we look forward to that day. Father, I ask your blessings on our shareholders who have suffered greatly as a result of the evils in this world, people that become greedy and decide that someone else's money is theirs, and they decide to do with it as they will. And as a result, we've got 50,000 plus people that have lost a huge amount of money in this stock. So we ask your blessings upon them. We ask your blessings upon this company as we endeavor to turn it around and make it into something of value for our shareholders. So help us in that, to complete that task. Help us in every way that we need your help, Lord, every day. It's only with your help can we be successful in turning this company into something good. So bless this meeting tonight. Give us wisdom, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so we'll continue on. Right, jump right into the meat of the matter tonight. As I say, it's been kind of a wild and crazy day to day, and of course, it's a wild and crazy life. Yeah, I'm sure many of you can identify. Our world is in a lot of turmoil, but it's a sign of the times, and have to take it all with a grain of salt. But you know, a lot of things happening politically in our country with the upcoming election, worldwide with market meltdowns and low oil prices and sovereign debt crises and on and on and on all over the world. So it's a crazy time to be alive. But thankfully we have a God that's in control, and he will see us through. So let's get right into the meeting as we usually do. I'm going to start off with our litigation update. I certainly hope that one day, whether it's with me or the next guy, that there won't be a litigation update. It will be done with litigation, and we'll be strictly updating on business activities and not court activities. But anyway, we've survived off of court activities. This company has since 07, and it's still here because of whatever monies we've been able to recover through the courts and through lawsuits and judgments and that kind of thing. So when you don't have a real business operation, that's, you know, you have to depend on that with a company that's been damaged like this. So anyway, let me start off with going back over the fact that we did receive thousands of pages of bank records from Wells Fargo. We're in the process of analyzing those. We've also gained access to another several hundred thousand pages of discovery that is probably even more meaty than the bank records that we got from Wells Fargo. So It's a monumental task to dig through all of this material, and I'll cover a little bit later how we intend to attack this more rapidly, because there is a huge amount of intel to go through. And, you know, people, you would ask, well, why in the world are we, you know, what's so important about that? Well, what's important about it is that the founders and insiders and their accomplices of this company took over $200 million and did something with it. And that's why they're all the ones that are still alive are under criminal indictment. So they spent that money either on their own fun and games or gambling or wild women or whatever it was, or they laundered that money into other assets. And so, again, those assets, although we haven't recovered nearly as many of those as I would like yet, but we do have a better plan working right now. Anyway, those assets are one of the ways that we will fund this company and turn it into something. And, you know, it's been excruciatingly slow. I mean, I've been into this deal now for almost 4 years, hard to believe. And, you know, we haven't recovered much yet, but we're right on the verge. So anyway, so all this discovery and information that we've gotten lately is valuable and will ultimately generate revenue for this company to be used to further the operations of the company and build it into something of value. So second item on the list, criminal trial, most of you may know, has been rescheduled. It was supposed to have been held the 15th of September, and the last minute was moved to March of 2016. Hopefully, the trial will stay on track for early next year, but it's not a thing we can do about it. It's out of our hands. It is strictly in the Department of Justice hands to figure out when to hold the trial. And as I said last time, last webinar, I mean, really, even though it's painful to have this kind of thing happen after all the hype and all the anticipation of, hey, we're finally going to have a criminal trial and maybe we'll get some justice, maybe there'll be some restitution, maybe we'll learn something that'll help the company and our shareholders, and then it gets scheduled back 6 more months. But in reality, it's probably a good thing. It's probably a good thing that I'm not 100% sure that these two new U.S. attorneys were ready for trial anyway. There's a lot of material to digest, and I'm not sure that they would have been ready to prosecute as effectively as they will be 6 months from now. And there's other reasons as well. But anyway, nothing we can do about it. Criminal trial now rescheduled for March of next year. Third item, as we have announced previously, the judgment debtor Nicole Durr filed an appeal with Nevada Supreme Court to contest a decision of Clark County District Court. Clark County District Court upheld our large judgment, which has a face value now of, with interest, close to $3 million. Durr has appealed that decision to the Supreme Court of Nevada. And what has happened in the interim, the Supreme Court of Nevada typically will mandate a mediation hearing prior to accepting the appeal. So we have a mediation hearing in Las Vegas on the 17th of September. And I had to go to Las Vegas. Our attorney, Bill Frizzell, had to go, and our local counsel, Jay Schaefer, was there. The judgment debtor flew in from overseas, although we never saw the judgment debtor. She was there in the same building. So mediation is an interesting deal. You have a mediator who's typically a lawyer or a judge who goes back and forth between the two conference rooms where everybody's gathered. We were gathered in one room, and the judgment debtor and her lawyers were in another room, and the mediator goes back and forth and tries to get everybody to settle on some form of compensation or terms or this or that or the other that will end the deal and get it out of court and save the state of Nevada money. And hopefully everybody will walk out of the mediation relatively happy with the outcome. So anyway, we went to mediation on 17th of September, and it was a very costly trip. I had planned to be out in Nevada anyway for the criminal trial, so it wasn't completely a shocker to have to go out there, but it was fairly short notice. So anyway, flew out there and sat in on the steel. So without going back and forth and covering the whole 12-hour ordeal, it was a marathon mediation. We started at 10 a.m. and we left about 9 that night. The mediator left about 6, but the rest of us stayed. The debtor and my attorneys and our attorneys and her attorneys hung around till about 9 o'clock, back and forth, back and forth. And at the end of the day, I mean, we did not settle the deal. We were offered a settlement. We were also told some things that we don't believe to be true. So in a nutshell, when you're dealing with people that don't want to negotiate in good faith and they don't want to be truthful and they don't want to pay their debts, it becomes difficult to negotiate in a mediation.
Hey, everybody. How's it going?
Of course, the mediator started out the mediation by telling us that he had attempted some collections overseas, like we have been in the process of doing, and he told us how impossible it is to recover properties or recover monies from overseas. But that's part of the game. I mean, he probably did have trouble, and the fact is about 99% of all judgments are never recovered. In fact, 99% of all judgments, money judgments, never get one red cent of settlement. Most of them just sit and nothing ever gets done with them. Frankly, the judgment debtor is in a favorable position in a lot of cases because in spite of the fact that they generally owe the money or they wouldn't have a judgment against them, the courts still protect them in some respects. And the deal is it's incumbent upon the judgment creditor, meaning us in this case, to prove and reprove and fight for your money. So that's what we did for 12 hours, and there'll be more to come. That's about all I can say on it at this point, but it's not over. We didn't settle, but we also didn't walk away with nothing, and that's all I can say at this point. So the next 2 to 3 weeks will determine what happens, and that could mean or continued drawn-out deal. It could mean a settlement. It could mean nothing. It could mean that we get nothing. But we'll know in the next 2 or 3 weeks which way we're going with this thing as far as that goes. And that's all I can say. But, again, I was appreciative of our lawyers. They hung in there with me. And, I mean, we locked horns and we went at it back and forth for hours and hours on very, very tedious details that are not fun. It's not pleasant. It's not fun in games because, you know, we all feel an obligation to the shareholders to get in something from every judgment we have that's collectible, and we need the capital to build a company. So anyway, so that's where we are. But like I say, it's not over. And the way we positioned ourselves at the end is about, under the circumstances, as good as we could have gotten, given the fact that you're not always dealing with straight up and honorable and honest people. So, all right, next item on the agenda. We have a new collections firm that I've hired. I've been working on this deal for a while, and as I've discussed in the past, it's very difficult to find anybody really that wants to do business with the former CMKM, now called New Horizons Holdings, Inc. People immediately, every time they Google they do a Google search on CMKM Diamonds Inc. and they get a bunch of garbage pulled up about, you know, everything under the sun, from pro boards to Akadaka on the internet saying 40 cents a share to somebody else, Hodges or somebody saying $10 a share to the fact that it was a criminal enterprise for many, many years, and that there was a criminal trial, and this and that and the other. So you can imagine it's just not easy to get anybody interested. But, you know, I've sat here for nearly 4 years, and we've worked on judgments, but we've had to do them given the fact that it's expensive and the company hasn't been well capitalized. And our lawyers have spent lots of money, and they're not huge law firms with millions of dollars to spend. So it's been kind of a one judgment at a time process, and it's become very, very tiresome to wait. And I know it is for you too. So anyway, I started looking for a way to sell some of these judgments or to get some other people involved in the collections effort. So after interviewing some folks and weeding out some and this and that, I've cut a deal with a Houston collections firm that consists of a very seasoned collections veteran who owns the company, two lawyers who are in the family, and then some other collections experts who've been in the, who've worked for larger collections firms and who are now working for this guy. So I've got a Houston firm now that's willing to come in, and we've basically cut a deal. We're just finalizing the last details, but they're going to come in and capitalize these judgment recovery efforts. We have the knowledge with Bill Frizzell and our lawyers there, with Frizzell and our local counsel in Vegas. There's a lot of knowledge about this deal. This new firm brings the capital to the table and a lot of judgment expertise. Their specialty is collecting on judgments, and they basically latch on and they don't let go until they take them one at a time, but they latch on to a judgment and to a judgment debtor, and they don't let go till they get something out of it or decide that it's not worth it. So I'm expecting some real action now. I mean, I've been patient on this deal, and I know y'all have been patient, and there's been good intentions all around, but you know, we've just come to the point of stagnation, just sitting here waiting on legal actions. It's just become unbearable. And none of us are getting younger. It's time for something to happen. So anyway, I'm excited about it. Everybody involved is excited. This firm that I hired, they're excited because it's one of the bigger deals they've ever gotten involved in. They've got an opportunity to participate in pretty serious collections. Of course, they'll get a cut of the action, but the company will still have a sizable portion remaining, and a significant cut of something is better than all of nothing or two-thirds of nothing. So everybody's excited about it, and I'm expecting to see some real action. We know of tons of assets that we can recover quickly that have been sitting there. And with all this new information, plus what we already know, I mean, there's going to be some exciting things, I believe. And I'm not just saying that to give you something good to think about. I mean, I'm just really beyond all of that. I mean, I just deal in hard fact. And a lot of times there hasn't been a whole lot of good news to share, but you know, in the dark of the night, this is a pretty good opportunity. So I'm thankful we found these guys. They've come well recommended. We've interviewed, met with them, talked about it, looked at their credentials, and I think they're very qualified to do it, and they're excited about it too. So the next few weeks, months, we should see some more revenue come in for a change to help speed up the process of building this company into something valuable. And it's certainly high time that we see some more income coming in so we can do something instead of just sit and keep the doors open. So that's some good news. All right, next item on the list, and I'm not going to stay on this too long, but if you want to talk about it at the end of the meeting, certainly feel free to ask a question. But I was asked by a few shareholders to attend this Paltalk session on 9/14 on this CMKM 2013 room or whatever in that room, where this fellow Akadaka came in and spoke about his insider knowledge of an imminent payment of 40 cents a share to CMKM shareholders. And I posted something on the website about it. I mean, I had sort of decided never to listen to any of that kind of garbage again, but the people that asked me to listen to it were good folks, and so in deference to them, I did listen in, and my anger started really getting angry the more it went on. I mean, I just can't imagine why or how anybody can get on the internet and start talking about something that's entirely false, and they have absolutely no proof of or no reason to be telling you. And so the motivation for this kind of thing is just hard for me to imagine. And, you know, I know most of you probably already know there's nothing to it. But sitting in that room, and you had a packed room, I mean, you know, we got 60-some people in here tonight. I don't know if there's anybody else listening in another room, but we got 71 in here right now. Well, they had, you know, the room was full, 250 people. And so obviously, the hope of 40 cents a share is still alive, and hey, I don't blame you. I'd love to get 40 cents a share for my measly 2 million shares, but I could use that money, and I wish it were true, but I just can't figure out how in the world people come up with this. Where are they getting the information? Why are they drumming this kind of stuff up, and what's the motivation? Is it just to get attention, draw attention to themselves, just keep people stirred up, pacified, or hopeful? But, you know, I could tell from the comments in the scroll that a lot of people bought into this deal, and they, you know, they desperately want to believe it. And so, you know, I can't change your mind, and it's really up to you, but I still consider it damaging to our shareholder base for misinformation to be floating around out there, especially when it comes to some kind of imminent payment between now and April of 40 cents a share. I mean, I'd love to see it, but it's just not real. And so I hope that after all this time and these these same people have come in and told, I mean, you remember the September 2013, where you were going to get paid in October and it was guaranteed and it was going to be much higher. And of course, that day came and went and there was not a whiff of anything good. So this stuff is all bull. And it's really not my place to get any deeper into it than that, other than I look out for the shareholders, believe it or not. And I care about shareholders, and I hate to see people drug down the path of believing and buying into something like this. I consider it garbage. It's immoral, at the very least, and on the borderline of criminal for somebody to come in. Now, I'm sure, I don't know if it's legal for people to do that or not. I guess you can get on the internet to say anything. But I don't know. But it's just not good for folks. I mean, there were people on there that obviously were elderly, and you know, one lady got on there and said, hey, don't burst our bubble. I mean, your bubble was bursted long ago. I'm sorry, but the people that are under criminal indictment, the ones that are still alive, they burst your bubble way, way long time ago when they took the money that you invested in stock and spent it in other places other than building a mining company that they were claiming. So the bubble was burst long ago. And I'm not bursting your bubble. Somebody else did that a long time ago. All I'm trying to do is help you have a shot at getting your money back. And I'm not doing that with false hope. The other thing that bothered me about it, and like I say, I raised my hand a couple of times and they didn't recognize me. I don't know if they knew who I was, but anyway, I raised my hand and never, and it's probably a good thing, because if I'd have gotten on my mic, I probably would have blown the meeting apart and it would have been an ugly deal. And I probably would have, you know, paid the price in terms of, you know, having to deal with the fallout of blowing their meeting apart. Because there were obviously a lot of people that want to believe it out there that attended the meeting. But so it's a good thing. I prayed about it when I was sitting here thinking about getting on, and I'm glad they didn't recognize me, and I'm glad I didn't get on there. But one of the things that bothered me, other than the fact that it's just total hogwash, and it's like I say, I wish it were true, but it's not. But what bothered me is somebody kept saying, well, what about the 52 or what about the 55 or whatever? And then there were people in the scroll going, I bet Tyler got that. Well, first of all, there ain't no Tyler, okay? Excuse my French. There's no Tyler anymore. We have a lawyer that works out of Tyler, and the company used to be headquartered in Tyler, but there ain't no such thing, excuse me, as Tyler. And anybody that thinks that the company is getting a cut of some kind of payout is absolutely out of their mind. So anybody that's starting that kind of rumor or believing in that kind of rumor, they need to look in the mirror and they need to screw their head on straight, because they're crazy. So let me say that again. This company is not participating at all in any kind of payout. And then there was a deal about the company's going to go away, or you can make your choice if you want to stay with the company, or you can take your payout, or you know, stuff like that. Crazy stuff. Absolutely false. 150% false. And if you don't believe me now, check back in 10 years and tell, you know, and I'll tell you I told you so. But the company is not going to disappear, and there's not some kind of payout coming, and their company's not getting a cut of the action and cutting the shareholders out of some of their money. So anybody that's continuing that kind of bull is insane. I'm sorry. I don't mean to be unkind, but they're bona fide insane. All there is left is just like I put on the website, folks. There's a small, tiny little company with me and a couple of lawyers that are trying to keep this thing alive and build it into something for you. That's it. That's your only hope of getting your money back. Sorry, I wish it were better news, but that's it. And the day that you can believe that and get your mind straight on the facts, the better off you're going to be. The sooner you can do that, the better off you're going to be. All I can do is tell you the truth. If you don't want to believe it, it's up to you. But I hope that many people will stop dreaming and living in a world out there where they're living their life and waiting on some impossible dream to come in and pay them some kind of big money. It's not there. And we can talk Bob Mayhew and Stings and this and that, all kind of conspiracy garbage, till 100 years from now, and nothing like that is ever going to happen. Your only hope of getting your money back is if this company can survive and thrive and ultimately return to trading, or if that doesn't make sense, remain private and start distributing dividends back to get your money back with a return. That's the only thing that'll ever happen that's good. Otherwise, it's over. And 99.999% of the companies out there that have been through this kind of criminal enterprise activity, stock fraud, pump and dump, whatever you want to call it, almost every one of them that have been through this kind of thing are gone. They're no longer in existence. And it's a miracle that we're still here. And that's a fact. And the sooner you, those of you who want to believe in a 40-cent payment or a $10 payment, the sooner you recognize that, the better off you're going to be. And frankly, the better off the company is going to be. Because there are people out there that give the company, which is all there is, no credit for anything. Don't believe the company's real. You think the company is some kind of corrupt operation or something like that, and nothing could be further from the truth. And so, you know, they diss the company and look forward to the 40 cents or the $10 payment coming, which is never going to come. And they trash the company and management and our lawyers on the internet. I still get an occasional nasty email from somebody. And, you know, about just crazy stuff that's far from true, but, you know, they've got their mind made up that they think they know what they're talking about, and they don't. And it's sad. It really is sad. It's sad for all parties. It's sad that people believe it, and it's sad that the company gets trashed so that when we need a lawyer or a collections firm or whatever, that people can Google search the company and all they read is a bunch of garbage from people that want to see the company go under, or they don't believe the company's legit, or they hate all of us and think we're a bunch of criminals or whatever it may be. It's really sad when people are busting the gut trying to help you out. So anyway, that's all I'm going to say on that. I guess I've probably talked longer than I intended to on that one, but, you know, I really found myself getting angry because I just hate to see people that should, you know, they shouldn't be allowed to do it. I don't know what can be done to stop it, but getting on the internet and stirring up a bunch of people over a 40-cent payment that is as far from truth as anything I can think of. So, anyway. The Amazon link is doing pretty well this month. I think we're up to about $150, which does help. You know, I got a bill from our accountant to pay. I've got a bill for the website upkeep. It's about $70 this month. By the way, I've got the tax return done, the 2014 tax return, and I will get that posted. I got it I had it actually done by the 15th of September, which was the deadline. Our accountant had to get it done by then to be on time. So anyway, I'll get that posted. It's just been really busy lately and just haven't done it. But I'll get it sent in to the web host and get them to post it. And, you know, it's nothing really to talk about. There's not much revenue there. For 2014, I think we had like 120-some bucks or something from the Amazon portal. And I don't think we ever made anything off of the Amway. But anyway, we still are carrying over $7 million loss carry forward, which is something that will come in handy down the road as we start generating profit. All right, so I'm going to touch briefly on the oil and gas business again. Last webinar, I talked about the potential of doing a Reg D offering and raising money for an oil and gas venture instead of waiting on litigation recoveries, and I have made quite a bit of progress in that area. Now, one thing I will say is I'm not going to be promoting a fundraiser on the internet. Some forms of these Reg D offerings are, it's not allowable to do a lot of promoting on the internet. So I will say that, you know, if you're interested in anything like that, just send me an email and I'll send you the information. But we are moving forward. I have a new LLC called New Horizons Energy LLC, and that's been formed, and we will be proceeding with raising funds to buy our first oil wells, and we will NHHI. This, the New Horizons Holdings Inc., formerly CMKM, will actually be a participant in the deal, and we'll have an equity share in the deal. So there will be revenue generated for the company, and the track record for NHHI will begin to build in terms of being an oil and gas company. So anyway, that is proceeding right along, and looks like it'll be a good thing. So if you have any interest in knowing more about it, just send me an email. Otherwise, not gonna belabor that tonight. But I do have a conference call for Thursday night with those who have expressed preliminary interest in the deal to answer questions and discuss where we are in the process and how the process will work. So, all right. So, I think I'm going to stop it right there tonight. We're only 38 minutes in, and I've covered a lot of ground here pretty quickly. So, all right, the question is, ACCA is currently promoting marijuana stocks like Willie on iHub. Is this company currently involved in marijuana operations? Or are you a normal person with good traditional family values like Russia? Wow. I don't know. I don't know how to take that one. Well, let me just tell you that we have nothing to do. This company, nobody I know has anything to do with ACCA. Yes, I've had people suggest that we look into the marijuana, the cannabis industry, because there's people making money in it, but I'm not going to get involved in that industry. So if that's the direction the company needs to go, I'm out. And so I'm not going to be involved. No, I don't believe in smoking marijuana. I don't, you know, this medical marijuana deal, I mean, that's questionable to me. I mean, I've known too many people that smoked it growing up and they were brain fried. Half of them ended up in jail or on harder drugs or totally bankrupt. Their lives were crushed. So I don't believe in it. But so I'm not going to be involved in that. So no, in essence, no, we're not involved in marijuana. And it's, I'm not going to be involved in marijuana, no matter what. I don't care how potentially lucrative it is or not. There's other ways to make a living, and that's not going to be one that I tackle. Hope that answered your question. Next one, Charles 5678.
Hey, Steve. Thanks for taking my question tonight. My question is, if any time in the future, if there was a situation that required a shareholder vote, do you know of any one shareholder or any one group of shareholders or entity that would have a majority vote? That's my question. Thanks.
All right. Well, that's a good question. I mean, here's the reality. I mean, there you got 50,000 plus shareholders that we know of with almost 700 billion authorized shares. Our largest shareholder, to my knowledge anyway, is there's still some, let me stop and say, there's still some shares floating around out there that we're going to cancel. There's some pretty serious shares out there that are going to be canceled. It's just a matter of our lawyer having the money to do it and the time to do it. And it's not something that'll make the company money short term, but we need to cancel quite a few billion shares. We've already canceled a bunch of shares in the past, but we got another 20 or 30 billion that need to be canceled. So, in other words, the company will claw those back into the treasury because those shares were gotten inappropriately. They weren't paid for like you paid for yours or I paid for mine or whatever. When we did the shareholder election back for shareholder director back in 2012, we got all these shareholders, but the company did not have the money to do a mailer, which is typical for a formerly or a publicly traded company or company with a bunch of shareholders. You've got to, if you're operating under strict bylaws, I mean, you send the shareholders a notice in the mail that you're going to have a vote. And then everybody's aware, assuming they open their mail, they're aware of what's going on. Well, in this case, we got over 50,000 shareholders. We don't have the money or didn't have the money at the time to spend on a mailer, which would have cost huge money, probably at least 100 to 200 grand to do a mailer. And so all I could do is I'm operating, the company's still operating under emergency bylaw provisions. The bylaws were rewritten and we have an emergency bylaw section and you can look at those on the website. But the company's still operating under emergency provisions and, in a situation like this with a company that was destroyed by insiders stealing millions of dollars, it's the only way the company can exist because you can't afford to have shareholder meetings in the strictest sense of the word where you reserve a stadium or a big meeting hall somewhere and have guards and the shareholder list. You just can't do it because there's no money to do it. So we're operating under emergency provisions. So all I could do was issue a press release and announce on the website and hold a bunch of webinars where all these candidates that ran for the shareholder director positions got to tell people why they should be elected and this kind of thing. And that's the way we did it. It's the only thing we could do. But at least we did it. And, you know, so what happened is that the two guys that were elected were primarily people that were promoted on the Pro Board of Millionaires, the Millionaires Pro Board. And I, poor Rush, I see you're on here tonight. You know, it's a very well followed Pro Board. There, I don't know, and Port Rush, you might want to comment on this when you get on the mic, or if you're going to type your stuff in. But anyway, there is a big following on that board, and the people over there, of course, it's their right to do it. I mean, they promoted who they wanted to be elected, and by and large, the two guys that got the majority of the votes were people that were promoted on that board. Unfortunately, one of the two guys, after he got elected, decided he didn't want to serve. So the only thing we could afford to do is go to the third guy in line. So we got Gary Rupp and Kevin Taylor. Kevin got the third most number of votes, and Gary Rupp got the largest number of votes. But to answer your question, and directly, and I probably could have saved a lot of time, I really don't think there is a, if you take our largest known shareholder, which has a little over 6 billion shares, and there are still a few other shareholders that have billions of shares, but in the scope of 700 billion issued shares, 6 billion shares is not, you know, a majority. So it's my belief that no, there is not a block out there that could influence the vote one way or the other, with the exception of what happened in the last vote, and that is the Pro Boards. Now, if we really were in a position to hold a full bore shareholder election and a shareholder meeting with a live audience and all of that, you know, we would be sending out mailers. I mean, that's down the road when the company has the money to send out $100,000 or $200,000 mailer. I mean, look at the cost of postage. You got to print and either a postcard, or you got to print envelopes and a mailer and then put the postage on it, even with bulk rates. You're looking at big money. And a lot of the people, I can tell you from the emails I get, I mean, a lot of people, the vast majority of those 50,000 plus people have written this deal off, and they don't think it's, they don't even know what's going on. I get emails every week from people, hey, I just found out the company's still alive. I'm shocked. I didn't know it was even still in existence. Or I found a stock certificate in a dusty drawer somewhere, and I found a website, and I was amazed to see the company's still alive. So most of the people don't even know what's going on, and that's a shame in a way, but it is a fact of life with a company that's finances have been so poor for so long. So I hope that answers your question. Let's go to One-Eyed Clyde. So in essence, I'm going to regurgitate again. I don't think there's, if we had a full 50,000 shareholders that knew about it and say 20 or 30,000 of them voted, I don't think there's any way they're going to block together. They're just going to vote their heart and whatever that means. And hey, that would be wonderful if we were in that kind of position financially to have that happen. And here's the thing. And this is something I firmly believe. The vast majority, it's kind of like the old silent majority when it came to U.S. voting. We got shareholders all over the world. The majority are in the U.S. and Canada. But the silent majority, even though there are people out there that would love to see this company go away, that hate the company, they hate everything we do, they think they trash us every chance they get or whatever, for whatever reason, the vast majority of the people that are out there, and I get this from the emails every week, is that those solid majority of people that don't really know what's going on, so that there's some hope of them getting their money back. I can absolutely attest to that fact by all the emails that I get and I respond to. people are appreciative of the fact that in spite of all the craziness with this company, that it is actually still alive, and it's, you know, there are people still striving for their benefit. So I think what you would have if you had a full shareholder vote is you would have people voting their heart or their business conscience or whatever it might be, but you wouldn't have any kind of heavily weighted crazy deal coming from, you know, out of left field. All right, so one-eyed Clyde, you're up. Okay, will NHHI and related new entities all in due time become and stay a private holding, not publicly traded? Well, so we don't have to worry about naked short selling. Well, that's, you know, the concern about naked short selling going forward, I guess, is potentially legit. In other words, if we did go back to trading, do we have to worry about some kind of massive naked short selling going on? Well, you know, supposedly the SEC is a little better in control, but Wes Christian told me the day I was at his office last time I was there that, you know, naked short selling still goes on every day. But we would just have to be, if we go back to trading, we're going to have to be ready to go, positioned to go back, have the right setup, the right product offering, the right everything, and we're going to have to be alert so that when there's some smoke of potential naked short selling, we got to be ready to get in touch with the SEC and help put out the fire. We just can't sit back. I mean, this deal, if there is naked short selling, which is still a belief by many, but not totally proven, if there was naked short selling, you know, that was just another smokescreen for the insiders to continue selling unregistered shares and putting the money in their pocket. So they benefited from the reality of naked short selling or the suggestion of naked short selling or something in the middle, and it just helped them perpetrate the activities that actually took your money. So, you know, staying private would be wonderful in that it is, it's cheaper, it's easier, but there's been such a big deal made about naked short selling with this stock by so many shareholders that if we ever get in a position to trade again, which is one of the main goals, then we probably should try it. But it's not going to be some wild and crazy loose operation with no financials, no reporting to the SEC. We'll try to get on a better board than Pink Sheets and, you know, where we can be in a little more controllable situation. I hope that answers your question. Again, this is all future hope for and wish for. It's not reality today, but there is still a goal to return to trading to see what happens about the alleged naked short selling. And ultimately, we've got a good enough business model to access the capital markets and bring in more capital to grow the company bigger. But again, that's down the road. So I hope that answers your question. If not, raise your hand again and we'll come back. Lady Barber, you're up next. Okay, your mom had stock and has recently passed away, and I'm certainly sorry for your loss. And condolences to the family. The only thing you can do is contact transfer online, and if you've got a pencil, I'll write it and give you the number. It's 503-227-2950. 2950. Call transfer online. Tell them whoever is the executor of the estate is, if there is an executor, or whoever has the power to do that. I mean, normally if there's a will, there's an executor, and the executor would need to call transfer line and then have the stock transferred to whoever the heirs are, whoever were specified to receive the stock. So it's a simple process. It costs a few bucks, but it can be done, and transfer online does it every week. I know that for a fact. So if you have any problems, just send me an email, and I'll be glad to try to help you. So again, sorry about your loss, and God bless. Hope that answers your question. Charles, you're back up. Yeah, I heard one little squeak there, and that was it. Can you try it again?
There we go. I wanted to say thank you for answering my question. I appreciate that. And while I was listening, kind of a light bulb went off in my head. I mean, it seems like we have about 83 members in this room, shareholders, who are truly interested in the company and the company moving forward. But as I look at some of the names in the room, it seems like we're all kind of fragmented. And you know, I don't know where people lurk at, but this venue that having the shareholder meeting is really, really good. And I appreciate, and I'm sure the other shareholders appreciate you holding this meeting once a month. And also the way you do it, where you red dot us and then you give us the update of the company, and then we can ask questions. The only thing that's missing is the ability of shareholders to communicate to one another. And certainly we can't do it at the meeting tonight. I mean, the meeting would go on forever. So like I say, the venue is perfect. But what I was thinking of was maybe opening a room for the interested shareholders, 80-something shareholders who are truly interested in getting, pursuing an ROI and pursuing the company and going forward, where we could talk and get ideas together to help the company and, you know, so that we have some good questions to ask you when you do hold a meeting. And this wouldn't be to interfere with any of the other rooms. I don't want to do that. I just want maybe one day a week for 2 hours or 3 hours that we're shareholders, where we can talk amongst ourselves and see where we can help the company moving forward and do something like that. I'm going to try to do that. I'll call it the NHH shareholder group. And like I say, maybe one day a week or something like that, where we can hash out what's going on and then try to, you know, have good questions to ask you. So that's kind of a thought. If other shareholders in here are interested, I am me. And again, you know, this is not to interfere with any of the other groups or anything. I don't want to do that. I just want those people who are passionate in helping the company moving forward to try to get to some kind of ROI. So anyway, I get off the mic. Thank you for allowing me to say that. And again, thank you for answering my question.
All righty. You're welcome. Good comment. And certainly, you know, communicate with me if I can help. I mean, I think it's a good idea. There are, you know, there are the Paltalk rooms, and they talk about whatever they want to, and some of it's, you know, pro company, a lot of it's not, but, you know, it is what it is, so that's up to the folks. That's, you know, not even my business, really. It's, I'm sure I've been slandered and trashed all over the internet, but that's okay. But yeah, if I can help you with that, I'd help you set up the room, or you can, I would say you could use this room, which is a possibility, but you can very easily go into Paltalk and set up a room and call it whatever you like, and it doesn't cost you anything to do it. And it's a good idea. So if I can help you, send me an email. I can give you my phone number, whatever, and I'll be glad to help you with that. And good luck with that. I appreciate your effort in putting that together. I think it's a great idea. All right. In the know, you're up. Okay, yes, in the know, I do have, and I've stated this long ago, Mr. Cassavant passed away on Valentine's Day of 2014, so it's well over a year ago. And I do have a copy of his death certificate, and I received a call from Melvin asking me if I had a copy of it, and I sent it to him. But so, yeah, I sent him a copy of it, and here's the thing, I mean, anybody, you know, if you want to go to contact the folks in Saskatchewan, the powers that be up there, you can probably get a copy of it too. But, you know, I'm sensitive about posting somebody's death certificate on the internet. I told her, Melvin, that he was free to tell people he had a copy of it, but I did not want it on the internet in deference to the family. I mean, it's just not, to me, appropriate. But it's a fact, the man is dead. And there are people, you know, this ACA-DACA deal re-clarified, there are still people out here that think he's alive. And, you know, well, I'm sorry, but he's not. I mean, that's not my call, that's the good Lord's call. And when our time is up, each one of us, he's going to call us home, and we'll face the great white throne of the judgment seat of Christ. I mean, it'll be up to him to determine. But bottom line, when our day is up, you know, we're going to pass on unless Jesus comes back before then. So anyway, the man is dead, and that's all I can say. I didn't want to post it on the internet because when I first took this job, my deceased wife's obituary, 10 days after I took this job, November 2011, she passed away. And curious shareholders posted her obituary on the internet. And frankly, it was very offensive. You know, I've got my kids' names and my grandchildren's names being flung around pro boards and all kind of things in a very sensitive time. And I just didn't think it was appropriate. So I didn't want to follow suit when Urban passed away and be like, oh, we're gloating over the fact that he's dead now. You know, that's not the case. I mean, you know, it's tragic for any family to lose a family member, whether regardless of who they were, what kind of person they were, anything else. So I was assured that it would not end up on the internet, but it's fine for people to know there is a death certificate available and that I've got a copy of. So that's a fact. Does that make sense? If you have another question, you can raise your hand again. All right, Comet, you're up. Hey, Comet, go ahead if you can hear me. You've got the floor.
Can you hear me, Steve? Hello, Steve, can you hear me? Anybody hear me?
Okay, we're going to move on. A comment, I'm sorry we didn't hear anything. I don't know if you're having problems or whatever. So feel free to raise your hand if you can hear me. I don't know what's going on. All right, Port Rush, you had your hand up earlier. I don't know if you can, but...
Can you hear me speak?
Yeah, hang on a minute here, Comet. Hang on. Let me just unread that you. Go ahead and try it again. Comet, I don't know if it's your computer or mine, but I'm not hearing anything. I did unread dot you again, so try it again.
Hello, Steve. I'm getting an IM. Other people can hear me.
Yeah, I heard you that time. Go ahead.
All right, so I'm glad you did, because I was thinking I was going crazy there. I think the idea that was mentioned before about going private first, and then as the company goes forward and becomes more established, going on to a bigger exchange, sounds like a great idea. It also, you may also have the eyes of the SEC better placed when you get there. The other thing is, I'm wondering if all the shares of those that stole from the company have been found or recognized and brought back into the company. And how do we know that some of these people that stole from the company didn't put it in other hands, so they, if the company ever got back on its feet, would benefit by it? And that's two things. And I got a third one. With all the climate change and everything that's going on being discussed in the media and by heads of nations and whatnot, will this company lean towards being eco-friendly when it gets going?
Okay, I'm sorry, I caught some of that. Again, I don't know if it's my end or your end. I think what you were asking is, how do we know that the former insiders, whatever, didn't give shares to other people, I think is what you're saying. But, I mean, we know for a fact they did, absolutely. There were shares passed out all over the place to all kinds of people. For all kinds of reasons, there were stock certificates generated by the transfer agent that, you know, went in all kinds of nominees' names and were sold into the market. The money was split, passed around, or whatever it might have been. So, absolutely, that went on to a big extent. And so, I'm sorry I didn't hear all of that. Why don't I give you the floor again if you can... If there's anything you want to add, I want to make sure I answer your question. So let me give you the floor again. Well, I don't know what's going on. Comment, you disappeared off of my screen, so I don't know what happened. I'm sorry, man. But come back. I don't know if you went off the air or what, but you're not on my screen anymore. All right, Port Rush, you're up. And by the way, while I've got you, all of you folks, Port Rush, I want to apologize to you publicly for the last webinar in that You had asked some legitimate questions that I misunderstood. And frankly, I thought, as I told you on the phone, that I thought you were trying to give me a hard time or whatever, and I misunderstood your motive. So, again, I apologize to you publicly, and I've done that over the phone, and I hope you'll forgive me for that. And, you know, so ready to take your question. Go ahead. This my computer's acting up. If you're I hope you're typing, poor Rush. I'm not sure, but anyway, go ahead or either take the floor, whichever you prefer. Okay, I understand. So Chris, the fellow who did not, I don't know if y'all can all read this, but by the way, you're not blocked from the room by any stretch. So. Have no clue why that would come up, but I'm not blocking anybody from anything. It's wide open. But okay, so Chris came from another board. You would know better than me, but I did. That was back in the day when I was reading some boards, and I do remember seeing some information about him on there on Millionaires. But I don't know where the guy came from, and frankly. Was very disappointed in the way it came out, and a guy that ran a campaign based on knowledge of claims that don't exist and on, got elected and then disappeared. It was not a pleasant deal to deal with, but anyway. The company is not prepared to see the board. No, absolutely not. When do I anticipate doing that? When we have the money to do it. And the board members that were elected do not, and let me repeat this again, they do not, and I'll repeat again, they do not want to serve without insurance coverage. And as I've said 1,000 times, the insurance coverage is very expensive. And so when I had these gentlemen and their wives at my house to discuss all things board related, we agreed that we would set aside a large chunk of cash to be a self-insurance fund. Now, in today's legal world, we talked about $100,000. That was just money that we did not need for anything else. Once the company had a free $100,000 that we could set aside and park in a self-insurance fund for the sole purpose of self-insuring the board and me, then we would do that. Otherwise, they're not going to serve. They don't want to take the risk, and I understand it, but they don't want to serve without that. So happy to have them, but, you know, first of all, a company, you know, I anticipated based on the information from our law firm that, you know, we would be in a lot better financial shape than we are. And we have been. So, we've waited a long, long time for money to come in. And I ran the company on thin air for quite a long time. So, you know, as I've said before, and I don't want to be accused of dodging a question, but I'm not going to get into what the Wells Fargo settlement consists of. We agreed not to. And to answer your question, does the Wells Fargo settlement not provide enough money, is a question I can't and I won't answer. So, again, that's just the way it is. We agreed not to discuss it, and we're not going to. So, if you want to follow up to that, you're certainly welcome. But there will be a full revelation of the of the Wells Fargo settlement on the 2015 tax return, which will be about a year from now, a little less than a year or less when it's posted. So just have to wait. Nothing I can do about it. That's what we agreed to do, and I don't want to risk the settlement by getting into it. But we're not prepared to see the board right now. We don't need a board, frankly, even though, you know, we elected a board, and they're, both of these guys know that when we have the money, they still say they will serve. If they don't want to serve, we'll reelect. You know, we'll have another election, but we're not, we don't have any operations to need a board. Now, at the time we did the election, it was part of an agreement that we settled with a group of shareholders that tried to sue the company pro se. I've been over that 1,000 times on these webinars. And we agreed to have a shareholder election. We did. We did exactly what we agreed to do. But when you got shareholder directors that don't want to serve unless they're insured, which I fully understand, you know, then they're not going to serve. And we can't afford to go back and hold another election just because they want to serve till we find somebody that's willing to step up and serve with no insurance. I don't advise anybody like them to serve. It's an unpaid volunteer situation in a company that has 50,000 shareholders that lost $200 million or more. You know, I mean, that's kind of like serving as a politician in a political office or a governmental office with no pay and just asking for yourself to get in trouble. I mean, it's not something that they should do. And I don't blame them. I mean, I'm serving without insurance, but, you know, if somebody wants to sue me, I'll defend myself and I'll countersue. Because I know good and well that we've done nothing but do something good for the shareholders. So if somebody wants to come after me, hey, good luck, because it's going to cost you.